the clinic, Leanne walks along the pool deck in a pantsuit, while people lounge and swim. She approaches an older man in a Speedo, stretching his legs.
I hope you don't plan to go swimming.
No, just swimming around.
Like to look at a half-naked man, huh?
She looks him up and down.
Kind of. Actually, I'm just taking one more look at the scene of the crime. Always seems to haunt my father. But I'm not my father.
Are you a cop?
I'm an attorney. Leanne McIntyre, co-counsel for Terry Landis. You a patient here?
Just some chef. What about we use the pool while I'm not working? Sam Babbage.
Nice to meet you.
Please shake hands.
You swim laps every day?
Half a mile every day, except some.
He dips a toe in the water.
Holy cow.
Then pulls a small thermometer out of the pool.
Would you read that?
75 degrees.
Thank you. You had a lot of nice big numbers on it, but I could read all the way across the pool. If I had replaced it with that piece of junk, I'll never know.
Leanne picks up the thermometer.
Anyone say why they replaced it?
No. Somebody decided they wanted to change. Dr. Dodd, probably.
Begins to grow. Soon after, she finds Ben on the sofa.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What are you doing?
I don't feel good.
Oh. I bet I know what'll make you feel better.
What?
Seven magic words. I was wrong and you were right.
Oh, what?
Dr. Dodd. He did it then.
Ben stares at Leanne, unsmiling. Later, in court.
Now tell me something, Dr. Dodge. How did the National Enforcer find out that Terry Landis is a patient at your clinic?
I have no idea. Maybe you should ask the National Enforcer.
They're shielded from revealing their sources. So how about who told the National Enforcer of Mr. Landis' treatment?
I don't know, Counselor.
Well, you have access to all his therapist's notes. I mean, his visit to Terry?
Yes. As head of the clinic, I consult on all cases.
There are details in here of his early childhood, stepfather abuse, early alcohol abuse. That information could only have come from one source. His therapist, don't you know?
I told you so. I don't know.
You didn't leak the story, did you?
Absolutely not.
It would ruin you and your clinic. Word got out that your staff was leaking patient information to the National Enforcer.
Well, and then when the story did come out, you knew
only one person could have leaked it outside of Terry Landis himself. That was his therapist, Alan Raffin. So, rather than let his greed destroy your clinic, he killed him.
Objection. Mr. Matlock is confused as to exactly who's on trial here.
Your Honor, the evidence against my client is purely circumstantial. I must be allowed to demonstrate that those very same circumstances might make someone else, maybe even this gentleman here, appear just as guilty.
Overruled.
Thanks. Carter Jacobson, not watching marriage return, ready to testify that he discovered the body at 11 o'clock. Now, where were you between, say, 10 and 11?
I was in my office, conducting a private therapy session. Individual therapy session with the patient, Ms. Altman, right over there.
Ms. Altman is ready to testify that you left your office around 10:30, right?
I suddenly remember that I promised someone that I would leave a package for them at the front desk.
She's also ready to testify that you were gone a good 5 minutes.
What took you so long? I stopped in my apartment to make a telephone call.
There's no record of you making a phone call.
The line was busy. I never got to it.
I see. I see. So, all we have is your word that you were in your room trying to place a call at the time of the murder. The same as all we have is Terry's word that he was in his room sleeping.
The police found his necklace in the pool that evening, not mine.
Don't you have a pass key to all the rooms?
Yes.
Why, so you could have slipped into Terry's room, stolen his necklace while he was asleep, dropped it in the pool after you killed Dr. Rack.
I did not kill Alan Rack.
Are you sure you didn't give the guard the envelope? Then walk up the hall, the west wing, open the emergency exit there, knowing the guard would go to the door at the east wing. I didn't trigger the alarm. It had done it 3 times the week before. And you knew the police would later suspect because of his necklace that Terry had done it. You knew that nobody would suspect that you had actually been the one who went in that pool and drowned in that way with employee.
It's not like I am not an attorney, but it seems to me you are coming very close to science.
Close? Yeah. I'd be knee-deep in it if one for one little thing. I've got proof.
Leanne opens the door for two bailiffs, who wheel a mattress and box spring into the courtroom.
Sam, that assistant chef at your plant is ready to testify that there used to be a thermometer at home on the north side of the pool at the deep end. It was there when we swam last the afternoon before the murder. But there's no sign of it here, see, in this picture that police took of the body some 7 hours later. He's also ready to testify that when he swam laps the next day, there was a new thermometer in his place. What happened to the old one, Dr. Dunn?
I don't know. Something disappeared.
My daughter is not only a fine lawyer, she's a fine detective. That thermometer disappeared because it got broken in the struggle while you were drowning. It either got broken accidentally or he broke it on purpose to use as a weapon against you. But anyway, when it was over and your colleague was dead, you couldn't leave there. Why incriminate you? So you scooped up that broken thermometer, took it with you. It was awful. It was waiting in your office. Time was of the essence. You could always get rid of it later. But you had to do something with it right then and there. And so you hid it under the mattress in your bed. This bed. The one the police and my dog with a warrant took out of your place this morning. Where you say, Doctor?
No.
Then why did the police lab find mercury in the fibers at the bottom of your mattress, fibers at the top of the box spring under? Because you got rid of that thermometer as quick as you could after the police left. But the broken stem had already leaked mercury into your bed. And it's still there. You killed Alan Rattler.
God swallows hard. Then he leans in close.
I told you.
Later, press around Landis on the courthouse steps.
It's great to be free, and it's a kick to know that our system of justice works, and not just on TV, but in real life, too. That's what I'm going to do next. My agent here says the networks are going to make my story into a miniseries starring me as myself. Thank you.
As Landis heads to his car, Ben and Leanne look on with Cliff.
Oh, Turk, I didn't even say thank you.
Oh, yeah, check right here.
What's on your mind, Ben?
Starving.
Ben waves to the vendor.
He lives.
Executive producer